Hey everyone, Shabby Gamer here, and welcome back to the WWE 2K15 Universe Mode, and this, which is night number 6 of the Best of the Super Juniors tournament for the Global Force Wrestling brand. Now, I'm going to start off by apologising. I have made a very slight cock-up in the logistics of this evening. You'll see very soon exactly what I've done. But let's have a quick look at the card I've got set for you tonight. We are actually going to start with a four-man elimination match. The winner will go on to face Kota Ibushi for the Intercontinental Championship tomorrow. That'll be Brian Cage, Shinsuke Nakamura, Uha Nation, and I've forgotten his name, but we'll find out very soon who that's going to be. So let's have a quick look at the rest of the card we've got set for you. We've got that number one contendership match that I was promising. Red Dragon, Kyle O'Reilly and Bobby Fish will take on ACH and Caprice Coleman with Cedric Alexander at ringside. The winner of this match will go on to face the Young Bucks tomorrow for the Global Force Wrestling Tag Team Championships. In match number 2, we have our first quarterfinal match of the evening. Angelico takes on Adrian Neville. Our next quarterfinal match will be Johnny Mundo taking on Rocky Romero. Our third quarterfinal will be Jay Lethal taking on Drake Younger. And our final quarterfinal is, as I said, the slight cock-up, as Kyle O'Reilly wrestles for the second time in the same evening, taking on Cedric Alexander. Match number 6 is leading on from yesterday's show, where Zack Sabre Jr. actually attacked Okada during his entrance. So we've got a singles match here. And if Zack Sabre Jr. does win this match, he will be added to the Global Force Wrestling Championship match tomorrow against Michael Elgin. And our main event is going to be the Junior Heavyweight Championship match as Kenny Omega defends against Matt Taven. So without further ado, let's get straight into our first match and see if I can remember who it was, who's the fourth person in that match. Here we go, the fourth person I could not remember is going to be Ricochet. So we've got Ricochet, Uha Nation, Brian Cage and Shinsuke Nakamura. The winner will go on to face Kota Ibushi tomorrow night for the Global Force Wrestling Intercontinental Championship. And this is a four-way elimination match as well, so it's going to be last man standing. We're going to see at least 3 pinfalls and submissions. Brian Cage and Uha Nation are both guys that have debuted over this past week. Great additions to this roster. Brian Cage, of course, is part of the tag team with Michael Elgin, the Unbreakable Effing Machines. Uha Nation, more of a singles wrestler, but he's really going to add a lot to this. I think he's already had a singles match against Ibushi a couple of days back and was firmly defeated quite easily. Ricochet was in the Super Juniors tournament, knocked out, was also had an opportunity yesterday to get himself a number one contendership for the Junior Heavyweight Championship and lost that match as well. So this is really a third chance for Ricochet to stamp himself upon this week. Great monkey flip there by Uha Nation. Kota Ibushi, he's been a great Intercontinental Champion here for Global Force. Has held the belt since the last pay-per-view. I think he has defended it once or twice. Mainly against Nakamura. I think he defended it against Nakamura a couple of weeks back at the Global Force Wrestling versus Ring of Honor weekend. Great arm drag there by Ricochet on Nakamura. Now Ricochet sending Brian Cage into the corner, following up with the elbow. At the moment, both Ricochet and Brian Cage are currently working for the Lucha Underground company, which is one of my favourite companies at the moment to watch. Although I am 9 weeks behind on my episode of Lucha. It's one of my favourite ones to watch, yet I'm 9 weeks behind. So I think I've said in one of my other videos, I'm really behind on all of my videos at the moment because I've been recording these, basically. I haven't watched a single episode of NXT since the last pay-per-view. As Brian Cage eliminates Ricochet, we are down to our final three. Ricochet again, not having a very good time. We're down to final three. Nakamura, Uha Nation and Brian Cage. Cage is watching as Nakamura pins Uha. Only for a 2 count. And yeah, as I said, I haven't watched any NXT since the last TakeOver event either. So I will at some point just binge out on both of those. About 2 or 3 weeks behind on TNA. But I can normally get through a 2-hour episode in about 10 minutes anyway with TNA. And WWE, I'm struggling with WWE recently. I just generally watch, I read the results on a Tuesday morning when I'm at work, and the if it's worth watching anything in particular, I'll come back and I'll skip through it to the specific points I want to watch. But I watch all the pay-per-views, but not overly interested in the weekly product at the moment. It's not great. Brian Cage, great discus clothesline. Nakamura folded in half. And Uha Nation pulls him into the center of the ring, goes to the pin. One, two, three, and that's it. We're down to Uha Nation and Brian Cage, who will go on to face Kota Ibushi for the Intercontinental Championship tomorrow night on our main night, the Super Juniors. It'll be night number 7. I'll tell you what, I'm looking forward to night number 7, mainly because it's going to be a great show, but also because recording 2 episodes every day has killed me, basically. Don't get me wrong, we will do something like this again in the future, thinking of the G1 Climax week-long shows as well, but I hope to be a bit more ahead, have all my normally weekly shows recorded, and then just do them on the side. Cage fighting his way back to his feet against Uha. As I said, Uha did have an opportunity against Ibushi the other day, and Cage, Brian Cage with the F5 on Uha Nation. And I think Brian Cage is going on to face Kota Ibushi for the Intercontinental Championship tomorrow. One, two, no, Uha Nation kicks out. How did Uha kick out? Oh, but Brian Cage with a pop-up powerbomb. But again, Uha fights back. Hits Cage with that German suplex. And this is a fantastic match between these two big, strong guys. Uha going for the pin. One, two, only a two count on Cage. Cage back to his feet. Catches Uha with a headlock. Uha back with a back elbow. Belly to belly suplex by Brian Cage. Pulls Uha in. Goes to the pin. One, two, three, and that's it. Brian Cage from the big belly to belly suplex defeats Uha Nation. Now Brian Cage will go on to face Kota Ibushi for the Intercontinental Championship tomorrow night. Great victory. That was the F5 by Brian Cage. I thought that was going to be it. German suplex by Uha, just launching Brian Cage. He lands flat on his face. Rolled him over and only for a two count. And there was a freak out from the belly to belly. So there we go. We have our... I've lost my piece of paper. Don't know where it's gone. Oh, there it is there. I've got my piece of paper back. So I'm going to put that in now. Kota Ibushi versus Brian Cage for the Intercontinental Championship. Another championship match pinned in for tomorrow. Remember, tomorrow night we are going to have the 2 semi-finals in the Super Juniors as well as the final in the same evening. The Young Bucks will defend their tag team championships against the winners of the next match. And we also know that Brian Cage will face off against Kota Ibushi. And now moving to our second match of the evening. It's going to be Kyle O'Reilly and Bobby Fish, Red Dragon, taking on ACH and Caprice Coleman at the CNC Wrestle Factory. Going for the number one contendership for the tag team championships here in Global Force. The winners will go on to night number 7 to face the Young Bucks for the, as I said, the tag team championships. As I said earlier, there's a slight cock-up in this episode as Kyle O'Reilly now has to wrestle twice due to a lack of logistical sense by me. But either way, I'm sure he can manage. We also have Cedric Alexander at ringside, who will be facing Kyle O'Reilly later on this evening in that Best of the Super Juniors tournament quarter-final. The main problem is if Kyle O'Reilly and Bobby Fish win this, Kyle O'Reilly will have to wrestle. If he wins his semi-final tomorrow, he'll have to wrestle 3 times, which is obviously a bit too much. So I know I should stay impartial, but I am hoping for a CNC victory here. And it's not, well, I say it's CNC. Of course, CNC is normally Caprice Coleman and Cedric Alexander. However, with Cedric being locked up in the Best of the Super Juniors as well, ACH took his place. ACH is part of that formation, the 3 of them together. So he's more than capable of tagging here with Caprice Coleman. As in comes Kyle O'Reilly. Caprice Coleman, for some reason, dropped out the ring for a second. Coleman comes across and O'Reilly catches... Sorry, Bobby Fish catches him. I thought O'Reilly tagged then. Have I just been completely lost in this match already? I'm completely lost. Bobby Fish is in the ring with Caprice Coleman. That's all we need to know now. Back elbow by Coleman. Went for the boot to the stomach, but Bobby Fish reverses. Some boots of his own. Brings Coleman back to his feet. Coleman gets around the back and hits him with a thump to the spine. And Coleman now brings an ACH for the first time in this match. There's a reverse sort of cutter by ACH going for the pin. One, two, oh, only a one count. Only a one count. Snapmare by ACH. Springs off the ropes and there's a dropkick to the side of the head of Bobby Fish. I'm sure O'Reilly will be trying to stay out of the ring for as much as possible in this match, letting Bobby Fish do the majority of the heavy lifting, knowing that he has to face Cedric Alexander later on this evening. Remember, one of the main reasons for this match is basically the Young Bucks. Nick Jackson was one of the main reasons that... Let's go for a pin here. One, too close to the Red Dragon corner. Nick Jackson was the main reason that ACH was knocked out of this competition on night one by Matt Jackson. It was Nick Jackson's interference. Then ACH got his own back later in the evening, helping Bobby Fish take out Nick Jackson. So that's where this little feud has come this week between, mainly between ACH and Bobby Fish with the Young Bucks. It's Caprice Coleman catches a boot from O'Reilly at the corner, then hits him with a belly-to-belly slam. But Bobby Fish manages to catch a hold of Coleman, giving O'Reilly some time to recuperate. And he's back to his feet. And there's the chop across the chest of Coleman. Coleman drops to the ground and there's a boot to the stomach as well by O'Reilly. Just to add insult to injury. Now O'Reilly making the hot tag to Bobby Fish, which is inevitably going to fail. And it does. Coleman across brings in ACH. Stone Cold ACH. Good spine buster there by Bobby Fish. Fights ACH off and Alexander's up on the apron. Referee distracted here by Cedric Alexander. ACH catching Fish with that running clothesline. Don't know what Alexander's trying to achieve here. Referee drops down for the pin. Only a two count. O'Reilly could have been, Fish could have been down and out there. O'Reilly got across nice and quickly to break the hold. Quick roll up here by ACH on Bobby Fish. One, two. Only a two count. Fish reverses. One, two. Again, only a two count. And we're stuck in an endless load of pins here. Referee's not even counting for this one. Finally does. And only for the two count. Why the referee just stopped and did not count there, I've no idea. But only stayed at a two count. ACH with a fisherman suplex. Bridge for the pin. One, two. Coleman takes out Kyle O'Reilly and that's it. Caprice Coleman did a great job there of blocking Kyle O'Reilly. And it's the fisherman suplex of the bridge and pin by ACH. Which means that this impromptu part of CNC are going on to face the Young Bucks tomorrow for the Global Force Wrestling Tag Team Championships. There was that, you would have said that Red Dragon should have won the match there, but here we go. Coleman catches Kyle O'Reilly as he comes running across to break the pin. Good victory here for ACH and Coleman. Red Dragon will be disappointed, but I'm sure Kyle O'Reilly will be eager to get his own back later on this evening as he faces Cedric Alexander in the quarterfinals of the Best of the Super Juniors tournament here. And here we go, our first quarterfinal match of the evening is Angelico and Neville The winner of this match will face the winner of Johnny Mundo and Rocky Romero, which is next in the semi-finals tomorrow, and maybe even progress on to the final. I think Neville, I did say he was one of my favourites going into this competition. Definitely a force to be reckoned with. However, there's no weaker members of this competition left. There was no weak members of this competition to start with, to tell the honest truth. We had 32 top-class super juniors. Helico now with a headlock. Throws Neville into this near side corner. Now a sliced bread by Helico. Gets around the back of Neville and catches him with that reverse tilt-a-whirl DDT. And then Helico starts to take some control, and commentator's curse there as he eats a dropkick by Neville, but Neville managed to avoid that crossbody in the corner as well. And Neville now with a tilt-a-whirl head scissors. Two guys locking up in the center of the ring. Then Helico comes out on top. Great head scissors takedown again. There's Neville with that back heel kick. And Helico takes a knee to the stomach now by Neville, and Neville with a drop kick to the knee. And Helico goes down hard. And now just the boots to the face by Neville. Bringing Helico back to his feet again. And Helico reverses it, catches Neville in that headlock, now whips him into the corner. And follows up with that cross body, but Neville again managing to avoid it. And Helico with a suplex. Neville again fighting his way back up to his feet. And Helico with a spin kick to the stomach. Catches Neville in the headlock. And Neville fights Helico away. And hits him with that tornado of head scissors again. There's a real lack on this game of guys using top rope finishes, I've noticed. I've not seen Neville hit the red arrow at all in any of the matches I've had him in computer versus. I've hit the red arrow myself when I played singles matches, when I've actually played the matches, but I've never seen the computer actually do one, so it'd be nice to see if he actually does that. Neville catches Helico with that hip toss and the tornado head scissors. Helico back to his feet, catches Neville in the headlock, and these two guys just a lot of reversals. Just reversal, reversal, reversal at the moment. Chain wrestling in the center of the ring. Now Neville with a scoop slam. And Helico back to his feet though. Spins Neville. Off them ropes. Neville comes back, and Neville with a quick roll up on Helico. One. Only for the one count though. Not enough damage done yet. Neville now whipping Helico over the top rope. Helico fighting his way back though. Quick roll up again by Neville. One. Again, only for a one count though. Neville spinning Helico around. There's a reverse Hurricanrana. Going for the pin again. One. Two. Helico kicks out after two after that reverse Rana. German suplex bridge into the pin by Neville. One, two. Again, only a two count. Neville went for that enziguri, misses. Helico back to his feet, going for the kicks. Catches Neville with that hip toss. There's the running shooting star press. Now locking Neville in the camel clutch. Not something we assumed we'd see from a either of these two guys. Helico puts Neville up on the top rope. Joins him up there. Helico. Oh, beautiful. German suplex off the top. Then a 450 splash. But Neville avoids the 450. That would have been a fantastic finish to this match. Dropkick to the knee by Neville on Angelico. Rolls him over. That's just stamping on the arm of Angelico. Knee to the stomach by Angelico on Neville. Neville looks a bit rocked here. And a quick roll up by Neville. One. Only a one count again. Angelico throws Neville against these ropes. And again, Neville with a quick roll up. One. Again, only for the one count. Drop toe hold by Angelico. Neville throws Angelico into the corner. Hoists him up onto the top. So you got a plan here. Frankensteiner. Brings him back to his feet. And Angelico reverses him into that hip toss. There's the shooting star press. Pulling Neville into the centre ring. Going for a pin. One. Only a one count. Barely a one count as well, should we say. Neville launching Angelico into the corner. There's the big kick. Angelico is down. Neville goes over the top. Makes his way to the top rope. Fights Angelico off. And there's that dropkick. And Angelico slaps that dropkick away. Catches Neville with a hip toss. And rolls him over. Into the camel clutch again. And that's it. And Angelico makes Adrian Neville tap out to the camel clutch submission. And again, this game refuses to allow Adrian Neville to use a red arrow. He must have had a finisher in his arsenal for so long in this match. There was a beautiful German suplex there. But Angelico will go on to the semi-finals tomorrow to face the winner of our next match, Johnny Mundo and Rocky Romero, as we crown our first ever Super Juniors champion tomorrow. And this is the second camel clutch. And Angelico victorious, part of the South African pride in this universe mode alongside Justin Gabriel. However, this could really launch his singles career. Well, it has launched his singles career, just getting to the semi-finals. But if he was to win this tournament, take it to the next level. Great win for Angelico. Against the odds, I think Neville was definitely the favourite, but can't take anything away from Angelico there. Here we go, our second quarter-final of the evening. Johnny Mundo versus Rocky Romero. We know the winner will take on Angelico in the semi-final tomorrow. And to get here, we're seeing Rocky Romero defeated Trent and then Bobby Fish to get here, as Mundo defeated Prince Puma and Ricochet. So essentially Ricochet twice, but still. Tell you what, Ricochet's had a terrible weekend. Or terrible week, sorry. Got knocked out of the Super Juniors tournament, was defeated in the Junior Heavyweight number one contendership match yesterday, and then defeated again in the Intercontinental Championship match this early this evening. I think he'll be happy to go back to CZW and use what he's learned. He is quite a top member of the roster in CZW. He went against Jerry Lynn for the the Wired Championship, sorry, recently. Came up on the losing side, unfortunately, but definitely got a big future there. As Mundo taking control with that knee from the springboard. Flapjack now by Mundo on Rocky Romero. Of course, Johnny Mundo is his Lucha Underground name. He's also been known as obviously John Morrison in the WWE, and for the majority of the rest of the indies, he's known as John Hennigan. Kept the same gimmick for everything, though. Although I must admit, since he's gone heel on Lucha Underground, it's a different side of Mundo. It's a very interesting side to see. Mundo back to his feet. Romero around the back. Mundo with the back elbows. Fights Romero off. The two guys lock up. Mundo comes out with a strength advantage with the French Chancery now. Twisting Romero around and hitting him across the chest. Knocking him flat. Romero's back up though. Tripping Mundo. And now sort of DDT in one of the legs. It's going to do some damage. That's going to shock your knee as well. Going to really add lasting damage, as I said. Standing shooting star press by Mundo. Brings Romero back to his feet. Romero fights him off. Boot to the stomach. Both these guys showing their knowledge of each other. A lot of reversals so far in this match. Romero throwing Mundo's arm into the mat. Bringing him back up to his feet. Mundo fights away. Boot to the stomach on Romero. Mundo with that great neck breaker. Rolls Romero over and now locking in a camel clutch. We did see Angelico win the last match. I wasn't overly impressed with that. But he won the last match with a camel clutch over Neville. Two of the best high flyers in the world. And the match ended in a bloody submission. It wasn't very impressive. Backbreaker, Russian leg sweep. Combination there by Johnny Mundo. Pulls Romero into the center of the ring. Going to go for the pin. One, two. Only a two count. Mundo manages to avoid that dropkick. By Romero. Romero with a neck break on the outside as well. Again bringing Mundo back to his feet. A shining wizard by Rocky Romero. With such force that his own and Mundo's body weight go crashing through the announce table. A bit of a piss take there, let's say the least, but still, the body weight of both guys crashed through that announce table. And Mundo really should have stayed in the ring there. Rocky Romero could have been counted out after being hit with a Spanish fly onto the debris of the announce table. Boot to the side of the head of Mundo by Romero. Romero wakes his way back up to the apron. Mundo brings him in the hard way with that hip toss over the top rope. Goes for the pin. One, two. Only a two count. I would have thought the damage done on the outside with that Spanish fly on the debris of the table would have been enough. Great arm drag there by Rocky Romero. Twist of the arm by Johnny Mundo. Romero reverse with a hip toss. Catches Mundo in the headlock. And there's a great exploder suplex. Could Rocky Romero be going through to face Angelico in the first semi-final? But no, Mundo's back up to his feet. Romero thought about a springboard but realised that Mundo would have avoided it. Mundo catches him with that backbreaker. Going for the pin again. One, two. Only a two count. And Mundo with that backbreaker, Russian leg sweep combo again. Surely that's going to be enough to finish Rocky Romero off. After being hit with a Spanish fly through the announce table, he can't have much left in his locker. Two, three, and that's it. And it's Johnny Mundo taking on Angelico in our first semi-final. It's going to be a full Lucha Underground match. This was the, as you see, that was the Shining Wizard and the body weight of the two competitors. Just went through that table, and there was a Spanish fly on the outside through the debris of the table. This was a pin, apparently. And this is the backbreaker Russian leg sweep combination that finished the match off. For the one, the two, and the three. Great victory here for Mundo. As I said, he will go on to face Angelico tomorrow in the semi-finals. And one of those two guys we'll then move on to the final at the Best of the Super Juniors tournament, which will be tomorrow night. Be sure to check that one out. We do have another two quarterfinal matches for you, though, this evening. Remember, we have Jay Lethal taking on Drake Younger and Cedric Alexander taking on Kyle O'Reilly. Our third quarterfinal match of the evening, Jay Lethal and Drake Younger, is underway. Jay Lethal borrowed from the Ring of Honor roster, and Drake Younger borrowed from the CZW roster just for this week. And one of these two guys will progress on to the semi-finals tomorrow night. Remember, Jay Lethal was the former Ring of Honor television champion, lost it at the very first pay-per-view to Michael Bennett. He's had a couple of opportunities to win that belt back. I know he's looking for another opportunity in the near future. Obviously, Austin Aries, the current champion, is here at the Best of the Super Juniors tournament. Got knocked out in the first round by Jay Lethal. So I'm sure Jay Lethal will be looking for a television championship match as soon as possible. We know that Austin Aries will defend his Ring of Honor television championship tomorrow. Depending on the result of this match, will definitely depend on who's involved in that match. And there's the arm drag by Drake Younger on Jay Lethal. Lethal fates Drake away. Great power slam by Drake Younger. And now just the elbow to the back of the shoulders of Jay Lethal. So as I was saying, to get here, what we've seen, Jay Lethal defeat Jack Evans and then Caprice Coleman. And I have got that wrong, haven't I? That's what it was. Jay Lethal defeated Austin Aries in the first evening. That's what it was, in that over the top rope six-man battle royal. And it was Davey Richards who defeated Austin Aries in the first round. So Davey Richards is also looking for a television championship match. Drake Younger has defeated Lowkey in the first round and then defeated Davey Richards in the second. And as I said, Jay Lethal defeated Jack Evans and Caprice Coleman to get here. Running elbow drop there by Drake Younger. I'm trying for the first time at the moment. I've got two laptops set up on my desk at the same time here. I'm trying to do editing on one while recording on the other and uploading as well at the same time. Just trying to speed the whole process up for you guys so I can upload as much as possible. I've got about a day. Well, I say a day behind. I normally, this is a Saturday video and CZW is a Saturday video, but I normally like to upload them on Friday night, so they're there for the early hours of Saturday morning. But I don't think these are going to be up till about sort of 3-4 o'clock on Saturday afternoon. I'm hoping it's worth the wait for you guys. Clothesline here by Drake Younger. Jay Lethal back to his feet though. Drake looked like he was going to go out for a springboard, but saw Jay get back to his feet, and Jay with a shin breaker there on Drake Younger. Now brings Drake back up to his feet. He's going to go for a suplex, but Drake reversed into a snap suplex of his own. Punch the stomach by Lethal. Twisting the arm of Drake, and there's the snapmare. Comes springing off that ropes and hits a dropkick to the face of Drake Younger. And now springboard splash catches Drake as he's making his way back to his feet. Catches him in almost like a crossbody. Instead goes to the pin. One. And he one count. Drake now twisting the arm of Jay Lethal, catching the front chancery, and then just a huge knee to the face. Jay lifted off of his feet and dropped to the ground. And just a boot to the chest of the seated Lethal there on the ground as well. Drake brings Jay back to his feet and went for a suplex. Jay reverses it into that neck breaker. And now locks in a head scissors on Drake Younger, then just a forearm to the face. Great neck breaker there by Lethal as well. And follows it up with the elbow drop. Jay brings Drake back to his feet, but Drake reverses, twisting the arm now of Lethal. Catch him in the front chancery, and then again just that knee to the face. Drake just walking around the ring surveying Jay, but he gave him a bit too much time to get back on his feet. And now Drake slides out of the ring. He's taken the top of the announce table. This is a brand new announce table after the previous match. Drake needs to realise he's not in Caesar W here. This is not how these matches finish. Almost a power slam. I thought we were going to try and get him through the table there. Again, a power slam on the outside by Drake Younger on Jay Lethal. Jay looks fairly rocked. The referee's still counting. Jay makes his way back into the ring before the count out. And there's Drake Younger with that almost like an angle slam for the finish. One, two, three. And Drake Younger is going on to the semi-finals tomorrow to face the winners of our next match, which is Cedric Alexander and Kyle O'Reilly. Great victory here for Drake Younger. Not expected at all for Drake to get this far in the competition. He is an incredible wrestler, but I think he's been against the odds in most of these matches. And there's that big finish. It's almost like a combination of a Death Valley driver and an angle slam at the same time. For the three count, great win here for Drake. So we have three of our semi-finalists penned in now for tomorrow's show. Who will join them? Will it be Kyle O'Reilly or will it be Cedric Alexander? We are going to find out next. Now it's time for our fourth and final quarter-final match here in the Best of the Super Juniors tournament. It's Cedric Alexander versus Kyle O'Reilly, as I just said. Well, as I just said for you. For me, it's been about a few minutes setting this match up. But yeah, I'll cut all that crap out so you don't have to see any of that. Great move there by Cedric Alexander. Kyle O'Reilly, I think, will be the favourite at the moment in this match, but can't take anything away from Cedric. Remember, this is the second time this evening that Kyle O'Reilly's wrestled due to a slight logistical cock-up by myself. O'Reilly ran the back of Alexander. An uppercut to the back as well. Tell the truth, I fancy O'Reilly to win this entire competition now at the moment. We do have, was it, Angelico, Mundo and Younger are the three semi-finalists so far, but yeah, I think for me, Kyle O'Reilly has to be the favourite out of the last five. Great kick to the back of the head of Cedric Alexander. And there's the belly-to-belly as well. Remember in this universe mode, a lot of the, just like real life really, with Ring of Honor and NJPW, a lot of our Ring of Honor stars will be switching back and forth between rosters, as will the Global Force guys. Switching between Ring of Honor and Global Force as they go along. So if any of these guys do win the Best of the Super Junior tournament, they will be placed here for a while. Obviously, the winner will deserve a Junior Heavyweight Championship match, which will come very soon. It'd be nice to see Red Dragon on this Global Force roster for a while, to tell the truth. It's a legit tag team. We've got quite a few tag teams in Global Force, but not a lot of great ones compared to what we've got in Ring of Honor. Obviously, on Global Force, we've got the Young Bucks. We've got the Forever Hooligans as well. Then we've got some, like the Lucha Dragons. We've got South African Pride, Angelico, and Justin Gabriel. We do also have Doc Gallows and Carl Anderson on the Global Force Wrestling roster as well as a tag team. As Alexander with that great move there on Kyle O'Reilly, almost like a reverse Death Valley driver. Brings O'Reilly back to his feet. Went for a kick. O'Reilly avoids it and hits a boot to the face of his own on Cedric Alexander. And there's Alexander there with a running style stroke. We do have Jado and Jido in this tag team division as well. Great blue thunder bomb by Alexander on O'Reilly. Could this be all here? One, two. O'Reilly kicks out after two. Gets caught with a power slam by Alexander. And again, Alexander with a pin straight away. One. Only a one count this time. I'm thinking maybe on Global Force we do need to split the tag team division up as they do in NJPW. And there's the GTS by Alexander and O'Reilly. And could Cedric Alexander be the final member of the last four? O'Reilly kicks out from the GTS. Avoids the kick, and there's a running meteor by O'Reilly. I can't believe that O'Reilly kicked out of the GTS. But now Alexander just following up with these clotheslines. And there's a big super kick to finish off. Could this be all? Now Alexander's going to continue the assault with a springboard elbow, which he connects with perfectly. Brings O'Reilly back to his feet. And the blue thunder bomb into the pin. 1, 2, 3, and that's it. And Cedric Alexander goes on to the semi-finals tomorrow to face Drake Younger. Great victory by Cedric Alexander against the runner play, as I assumed. I just thought that Kyle O'Reilly would have this. But I've been wrong in every single match in this universe mode so far. I think whoever I think is going to win always seems to lose. But after only the two count from the GTS, you wondered if O'Reilly was destined to come back and win this match. But it was a blue thunder bomb that finished it all off for the three count. Great victory here for Cedric Alexander. He's definitely put the other three guys in these semi-finals on notice. So as I said, he will go on to face Drake Younger tomorrow in the semi-final, as well as Mundo taking on Angelico in the other semi-final. So we know one of these four guys is going to be named the best of the Super Juniors. Here we go, match number 7 this evening, and this leads on from yesterday when Zack Sabre Jr. attacked Kazuchika Okada during his entrance. This match has been announced that if Zack Sabre Jr. can defeat Okada, he will be joined into that Global Force Wrestling Championship match tomorrow, which will make it into a triple threat, and Elgin would have to defend his championship against Okada and Zack Sabre Jr. Zack with that beautiful octopus stretch. So early on in the match, doing damage to, every single part of the body of Okada, really. It's a Russian leg sweep by Zack. A drop toe hold as well. Okada catching the leg of Zack Sabre Jr. and hitting the dragon screw. And we do still have our main event for you this evening, as Kenny Omega will defend his junior heavyweight championship against Matt Taven, who earned the right in an over-the-top rope six-man battle royal yesterday. And then that will be the end of our evening here tonight. Great reverse cutter there by Zack Sabre Jr. Not had the best of times so far. He had a great victory in his debut. Then he was attacked by Okada, but since then, Okada has really dominated Zack at most points. Zack trying to get his own back last week, as we saw with the attack on Okada during his entrance. Great reverse sort of suplex, dropping him down hard, and there's a drop kick to the back as well. Zack Sabre Jr. fights Okada away and catches him with that hip toss. Okada with that running forearm now brings Zack out, makes his way up to the top rope, and Okada, oh, a basement drop kick to the seated Zack Sabre Jr., followed up with the elbow drop. And the Rainmaker is really causing some problems to Zack here, but Zack catches him with that belly-to-belly slam. Okada with a headlock on Zack, comes back with that drop toe hold. It's the boot to the arm as well. Quick roll up by Okada here. One. Only a one count. Not entirely sure Zack's shoulders were both down there on the mat anyway. It's a neck breaker by Okada on Zack Sabre Jr. Going for the pin. One. Only the one count. Zack avoids the the Enziguri. And another belly-to-belly slam on Okada. See, both these guys have been doing some more research on each other. There's a lot of reversals in this match again. Zack now just slamming Okada's head back onto the mat. A huge kick to the spine. A football kick there. Or if you're American, a soccer kick. And again, just slamming Okada back. Head first onto the mat. Brings him back up to his feet. Spins him round. Dragon suplex. Thought he was going to hold the arms there and go for a bridge and pin, but he decides to pull Okada away from the ropes. Probably would have been a rope break, but a two count there. Maybe he would have got the three count if he'd kept the pin straight off. Okada launches Zack into these near ropes and catches him in the drop toe hold. Spins him over. And just a boot to the inside of the thigh. Now Okada making his way outside the ring. And now Okada's taking the top of the announce. This announce table is getting a hell of a beating tonight. It really is. Sabre trying to back away from Okada. Okada just launched into them ring steps and catches his feet there. And now Okada's bringing Zack over towards this table. Changes his mind though. Whips Okada down. Whips Zack Sabre Jr. down the side. Zack's back in the ring. Taunting Okada. Okada went for that dropkick. Zack avoided it and Zack has Okada up. And there's a Michinoku driver. Pulls the legs back for the pin. Two. Oh, and a two count. Zack Sabre Jr. denied the victory. Okada looked like he may have been going for the Rainmaker. Clothesline there. And now Zack looked like he was going for that reverse suplex. Okada kicked out. Now Zack tripping Okada. These two guys just know each other so well now. They've had a lot of matches over the past couple of months. Pinned by Zack only for the one count. Zack twisting the arm of Okada. Okada with a knee to the stomach. Great dropkick by Okada. Elbow drop to the center of the back there, right at the bottom, lower back. Okada has Zack up on his shoulders. Zack again reversing with that reverse DDT. Now Zack's going to go for the cross arm breaker, but Okada's very close to the ropes. And catches the rope straight away. Zack won't be happy with wasting that move so close to the ropes. Okada now with a belly-to-belly slam on Zack. And just stamping on the arm there, doing some damage of his own. Zack fights his way back up. Boot to the stomach of Okada. And Okada with a quick roll-up in the center of the ring. One, two. Only a two count. Zack kicks out. Zack with a snapmare on Okada. Catches him in the boot to the head. Okada with the snapmare locking in the submission of his own. But Zack's feet was under the ropes. Zack with a drop toe hold. And a stamping on the back of the arm of Okada. Obviously getting him ready for another one of those cross arm breakers if he can lock it in. Snapmare again by Zack. Pulls Okada away from the ropes. What does he have planned here? He's going to go for a pin. One, two. Only a two count. And now Zack has Okada up on again. And Michinoku driver sent to the ring. Surely this has got to be all one, two, three. And it is. Zack Sabre Jr. is victorious here. And now we know that our Global Force Wrestling Championship match tomorrow evening is going to be a triple threat as Michael Elgin now has to defend against both Okada and Zack Sabre Jr. There was a quick roll-up by Okada earlier on. It was a pin by Zack only for a two count. But then manages to catch Okada straight away up for the Michinoku driver. Slams him down, pulls the legs back and gets the victory. One, two, three. Great victory here for Zack. Like I said, he hasn't had the best time so far in this Universe mode. So getting the victory here and giving himself the opportunity to go for the Global Force Wrestling Championship now is really, really going to boost his confidence. Great victory here. Michael Elgin can't be happy about the situation now. He's gone from defending his championship in a one-on-one match to now having to face two guys tomorrow evening. The following match is scheduled for one fall, and it's for the Global Force Wrestling Junior Heavyweight Championship. And here we go with our main event this evening. Kenny Omega defending his Junior Heavyweight Championship against Matt Taven, who won the six-man over the top rope battle royal yesterday to get the opportunity here. And as you can see, Matt Jackson's made his way to ringside to support his fellow Bullet Club member, Kenny Omega. One thing I've just noticed that I didn't know, to tell the truth, and you won't have seen this because I would have cut it out, but I've just been noticing a loading screen, and it does mention that the apron DDT, which quite a few of the guys have used, is quite popular. I didn't realise that's an Oh My God moment. I didn't realise that at all. So, yeah, you learn something new every day. Neckbreaker by Taven. Remember, Taven is a member of the Ring of Honor roster, so if he was to win a championship here, he would have to work for both rosters simultaneously, as you do. However, I'm sure Matt Jackson on the outside is really going to try and avoid that happening. Of course, there's Kenny Omega as well. Kenny's more than capable of winning this match on his own. But just having Matt Jackson on the outside just gives him that added insurance that he requires just in case. Kenny Omega throws Taven across and hits him with that running dropkick. And now just boot across the throat. Gets around the back of Taven. Kenny Omega is also the man with my favourite finisher manoeuvre in wrestling at the moment. If you don't know it, it's where he gets the guy up in an electric chair, so he's sat on his shoulders essentially. Then he drops him but catches him halfway down into a deadlift German. It's an amazing move. There's a Taven's up on the top, and there's a dropkick to the seated and grounded Kenny Omega. A clothesline as well to the grounded Kenny Omega. Taven starting to take control of this match. Could we see a new Junior Heavyweight Championship here? Remember, Kenny Omega has been the Junior Heavyweight Championship champion since this Universe mode started, which was about 3 months ago now. So one of the only belts currently in this Universe mode which is still held by the original champion. It's the only belt in Global Force Wrestling. Omega there with a neckbreaker on Matt Taven. I'm just trying to think if there's any other belts now. I think Dean Ambrose at Caesar W has held the championship since the very beginning. Dolph Ziggler in the current day WWE has held the Intercontinental Championship since the beginning. And I think it might just be those three. I know the Blade Runners in the retro roster have also held the Tag Team Championship since the beginning. That's probably the most impressive, because they have defended their belts quite a lot. But they just seem to be able to defeat all comers. Elbow drop there by Omega. Taven back to his feet, and now Omega locking in an ankle lock. Perfect ring positioning, really, but couldn't quite get enough of it. Taven back to his feet, and there's the back elbow by Taven on Omega. And there's the stroke by Taven. Goes over the top rope, going to go for a springboard. Omega manages to avoid the springboard, though. Brings Taven back to his feet. Whips him into this corner. Taven reverses, but Omega flips over the top of him. Springs off this inside rope. Comes back, and there's the diving forearm. And there's a Hadouken. The Hadouken. I really must change that, because it just doesn't look very strong at all. But it is one of his finisher manoeuvres, and Taven straight back up to his feet. Omega's stunned. And here it is. electric chair, dropped into the German bridge into the pin. Oh, for a rope break. Oh, Kenny Omega hits my favourite finishing manoeuvre. And unfortunately is unable to really get the full effect out of it. Great running shoulder block by Omega. And just slamming the arm of Taven into the mat. Going for the pin. One, two. Oh, so close to a freak out by Omega. Omega's done this all by himself as well. And Matt Jackson has yet to even get involved in this match a single time, which we know the referee generally lets him have three or four before he bans him from ringside. Omega now over the top rope, goes to the springboard splash and hits it beautifully. Brings Taven out from the apron, eight from the corner even. Going for the pin. One, two. Oh, again, only a two count. Taven kicks out. Two guys locking up again in the middle of the ring. Omega, the French Chancery. Scoop slam. Taven's back to his feet and trips Omega. Now catches that leg. And DDTs it, just jarring the knee. And again, going for it again. He just DDTs the knee. And jars, there's some shock damage that will to the knee. Omega doesn't look too phased at the moment though. As he reverses Taven in the corner and hits that drop kick. And now just pushing his foot into the throat of Matt Taven. Over the top rope he goes and there's a springboard splash. Beautiful. Pulls Taven into the centre of the ring. He's going to go for a pin here. He does. One. Two. Oh, and again, so close to a free count. What does Kenny Omega have to do? And this could be it. Up on his shoulders, electric chair. Drops. And there's the deadlift. German, one, two, three. And Kenny Omega retains his junior heavyweight championship here against Matt Taven at the Best of the Super Juniors tournament, night six. Fantastic, fantastic match here by Omega. That was a stroke early on by Taven. Omega hit the Hadouken as well, only for the two count. That was one of the many, many close three counts that Omega had. But this is what finished it off. Electric chair caught into the German suplex, into the bridge and pin. Absolutely amazing finisher maneuver. And Kenny Omega is victorious here. There he is, holding his championship high, as he deserves. So we now have our entire card for tomorrow set. It's going to be a fantastic finale to our Best of the Super Juniors tournament. We know that Angelico is going to face Mundo in the first semi-final. Cedric Alexander is going to face Drake Younger in the second semi-final. Then we know that ACH and Caprice Coleman are going to take on the Young Bucks for the Tag Team Championships. Kota Ibushi will have to defend his Intercontinental Championship to Brian Cage. Austin Aries will defend his Ring of Honor Television Championship in a triple threat against Jay Lethal and Davey Richards. Then we're going to have the Best of the Super Juniors final match before moving into our main event this evening, where Michael Elgin will defend his Global Force Wrestling Championship against Kazuchika Okada and now Zack Sabre Jr. as well. So be sure to check that out. It will be uploaded this evening, so it should be ready for first thing Sunday morning. I hope you've all enjoyed this episode. I've definitely enjoyed making it, although it has gone incredibly long, a lot longer than normal. So I'm going to leave it there. I've been Shabby Gamer. Thank you very much for watching, and goodbye.